like I'd said in the beginning, what had happened to me was that there was this huge, we call it awakening for lack of a better way of describing it. You have something happen where something else speaks to you and you know it's not you. After that initial experience, it's happened quite a lot of times actually, and it's something that you're often reluctant to talk about because people just think you're crazy and they don't understand it. There's nothing to say, well, there's people that get spoken to. What I've learned in recent times, and this is why I'm happy to talk about it these days, the best way I can describe it is like a near-death experience while you're awake. You get this download of information and afterwards you're changed because you know it's real. And there was one episode where I shut my eyes and it was like code coming through me. At the same time, it was like a movie flashing, 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 flashing. So when you go into the movies, you'll see this, you know, flash of what's to come type thing. Well, there's that, but you get the information. And I guess to put it as it is, what I got was man's been around for millions of years, not just thousands of years. There's a history before our history, before that history, before that history. Women were the healers. Women were actually more, I won't say in control, but women were it. Women were it. It was, they were the nurturers, they were the carers, they were the teachers. So, and then over millions of years or thousands of years, you know, as the planet has evolved and then destroyed and then evolved again and destroyed itself and evolved again, they've realized that there are people, you know, I get into aliens, it all sounds really, really weird, but a different agenda to suppress that power of woman. If we look at the way things are now, and don't take my word for it, Nicole, go out and do your research, as I've always said. But those experiences are where you get information and you think, well, I know it's not a dream. I know I was quite conscious. I was quite conscious when that happened. So it's not like you wake up and you've had this dream. Then you try to go back to your life and you can't. You can't go back to what you were before because you know that everything is what you thought is not what it is. So now you try and deny it and you try to just go on with your day-to-day routine and then you come back and you're like, I can't. What I've realised, though, with that, what we could call a near-death experience while you're alive, or a download or something, when I look back, it's happened when I'm under certain vibration. I'm either surrendered, in other words, I give up, and I've got no thought of poor me, or look at the troubles, or, you know, can you pay your bills, or whatever it is. There's none of that. It's just like, I give up. So, in other words, you've got an empty space there. So, this will come through at that time, or when you are in a state where your vibration, we talked about that before, frequency, I'm tuned to the same source, energy, I'm tuned into that. So you can be like in this really happy time and you're in bliss in the moment, whatever it is. And then all of a sudden, something just comes into your body and all of a sudden you're going, oh, whoa, I'm seeing something else, I can't explain this to anyone else. And you can't deny it. I think now that the world has come to a stage where this is happening to hundreds of thousands. And a lot deny it because they don't know what to do with it. Once you accept it, it seems a bit more comes, and a bit more comes, and a bit more comes. And what it is those that are getting this, have to take action and work with others to get them to the same. So my job is to teach you, not to teach you how to do this, teach you how to find your balance, your tune, your harmony, your in-tune, your harmony, your ease instead of dis-ease. And that's when it starts to happen. I think the time is right. And what's happening, though, we've got a different agenda, and I've spoken about this before, and it's like, well, how do you explain the politics, the Illuminati or aliens or anything to do with that without sounding just too far-fetched? But I'm going to put it out there anyway. There is a different agenda from higher up a ladder that is knows that this is possible for us to tune in and know exactly what is happening in the world, in the universe. And so by taking us out of balance, disharmony within us or dis-ease within us, it starts to control us. So, as I've said, don't be around electromagnetic fields as much as you can. Switch off your TV, switch off your power when you can. Don't be living in places where you've got that bombarded around. I mean, it's easier said than done. We can't all go and move and live in the country, of course. But those sort of things are what's causing us to be mind controlled, dumbed down. I mean, one of my heroes is Richard Bland. He tells it as it is, you know. He's just, you know, I listened to an interview with him and someone said, you know, are the aliens there? He says, oh yeah, they're real. And you know that he knows. When people talk about it and we know what we're talking about. A lot of bullshit out there, of course, but you start to go from one thing to another thing and all of a sudden you go, I think there's something in that. People are saying this and we didn't get it, but there's something within that. So to sum it up, go back to doing your research. There are cover-ups after cover-ups. We talk about aliens as if, you know, you're crazy and this only happened in cartoons or comic magazines. The thing is, there's underground bases being built. They are building centres that are like concentration camps, and they will eventually, over the time, the elite will own the world. That's their plan. The people that have certain credentials that will make good workers will be out there working. Those that are nothing, those that are unemployed, the elderly, the sick, all of those, they are nothing but like cattle. They'll be put into these camps and used as food. You know, it's really coming to that, and it frightens me that I have two grandchildren and they're going to inherit this. No, I've got to do something about it. I've got to do something about it, you know, and I don't care what it takes. I can't go back. I can't go back to the way that I live life, because once you know it, well, you can't. You just can't go back to that way. Everything I do now, whether it be through books, through videos, through radio, through seminars, through training programs, is all about helping people to get back into a balance, into a harmony with themselves, so they get that same connection. They get the truth for them too. I'm not saying go and research it and take my word. Get in touch yourself and you'll find it.
Is the connection the vibration that you're speaking about?
Absolutely.
Can you explain that a bit more?
Well, if you look at, I think I have sort of touched on it, but the frequency of love, or the frequency of the planet, is 528 hertz. So start to look at the hidden secrets of vibration. There's a lot of research out. Tesla was talking about it. Einstein was talking about it. So basically our thoughts are living. What comes out of our head and hits this matrix that is all around, or I've talked about it as the plasma, what hits it after just over a minute, we think about it for so long, once it leaves our head, it has a life of its own, and it travels ahead and starts to, like the law of attraction, isn't quite like the way they explain it, but it starts to attract like-minded vibration. So if you've got a vibration of love, happiness, joy, it's all a certain frequency. If you've got hate, resentment, victim, poor me, war, destruction, same sort of vibration. So if you're putting out a vibration that's leaving there, oh, I resent that person, I don't like this, you're going to attract like type things. In other words, shit's going to happen because you're putting out that shitty type of vibration. I look at it this way. So once it's left your head, it's left your head. It's on its way. So if I decided right now to change the way I use my mind and I go, all right, as of today, I'm going to listen to 528 hertz through meditation every day. I'm just going to start to bring my body back into balance, etc., etc. Remember, there's stuff that has already left and it's already on its way. It's like karma. Shit's already going to happen. And I gave the analogy at a seminar once where, you know, here you are starting today. A month ago, you hadn't got that, so you were still thinking, shit, it's already left, it's on its way. So here you are, you want to change. A month down the track, all of a sudden you look around and you're standing in this big pile of shit. And you go, where did this shit come from? I've got my thinking right, I've got my vibration right, I'm not just thinking positive, I'm vibrating positive, I'm not letting any rubbish into my head. Where did this shit come from? And then you go, oh my God, that was the shit I thought 2 months ago. It's finally hit me. So we have this momentum that has started that we're going to have to deal with. You can't wipe your slate and go, right, no shit from today. You're going to have shit that you've thought or added momentum to, in other words, thought about and thought about and thought about. You know, they used to say spend 10% on your problem and 90% on the solution. That's not right either. I don't want to spend any more than 10 seconds on it, because otherwise it's got momentum. Esther Hicks talks about it when she's channeling through Abraham, of this hill, and here's this car on the top of it. And you're thinking, and after 68 seconds, that thought has left. Now it's on the way down. Now, it doesn't matter where you stand along that hill, this car has already left and it's going to take you with it. So once the momentum has started, it's come. But when you're here, you can stand in front and stop that car from going. So I think, okay, I've got my stopwatch out, and I think of all the shit I want to get it out of my head. Just on 60 seconds, on the minute, stop thinking about it and do something else. Now, it's easy to say stop thinking and do something else, because we tend to like to wallow as humans. We've been taught about that, you know, wondering about the problems and, give thought to it and all that, because that's the way we think we're going to solve it. We're going to give thought to it, so we're going to solve it. Whereas the solving doesn't come from the mind, it comes from the soul. So if you get out of the mind and go into the soul, the solution will come. The energy source, the living consciousness will come in.
When you're saying soul, do you mean in heart as well?
Heart and soul is one. That chakra, we're not talking about a physical heart. We're talking about this as a connection to that. And that's what has happened to me. You get these, it's not even a knowing, it's just... It's like if somebody said to me, and I don't know if I've already said this, do you know you exist? It's not, or do you believe you exist? So I don't believe, I know. And it's like that, you just know, and you there's no question, it can come through. With me, it either comes as a voice or pictures, images that'll come through. And those images say everything. I remember once when I got this download, I have never cried so much in my life. When they say cry a river, you had to be there to see the amount of water that poured from my eyes. Not just, I mean, literally, you could fill a cup with these tears, and I was crying, and I didn't know why I was crying. I couldn't tell you why I was crying, other than I was crying, just this emotion. This was after I had all these pictures. When I stopped, you would expect, it must have been like 15 minutes. When I stopped, no red eyes, no red nose. It was like I hadn't cried at all. And it was like, that is just, normally if you're crying, your face swells up and you look like you've been crying. There was none of that. It was just like the tears of the pain of all the women that have ever lived and the suffering of women. So I knew with that, I had felt their pain, but it hadn't affected me on the physical level, so to speak. The tears were coming out as a release. And I knew then that my thing was to educate, to bring women back. Now, I've been working through time with menstruation and circumcision of women and bringing back power and that of women. All my life, that's where I've been. I mean, if you trace it back, even with women in prostitution, I was working to get prostitution legalized back when I was 17, 18, because I had a friend that was a prostitute and was murdered on a job. And when she didn't come home that day, it was a couple of weeks before they found her. So she'd been murdered and dumped, and no one even knew where she was. And I thought the best thing we can do is put legalized establishments, have cameras, have security, make sure these women are safe. And this has been going on. You know, how many countries where young mothers are selling their girls into prostitution for money, and it's not safe, they're getting AIDS, they're getting that. So I'm not saying become a prostitute. I'm saying if you're going to do that, at least be safe in it, workplace safety. Yeah. So I've always been working on the rights for that. And I now know that education has to come from women, because women are the nurturers. We get it far better than what the men. The men are still in, they think up here, or maybe it's through their ass half the time. I shouldn't say that, but I did. But they don't have that right brain side as much as we. And it's nothing to do with our left brain. That's where we're being indoctrinated. And I said earlier about, the vaccination and what not to do. They are drugging us through foods, through chemicals, through vaccination. They are changing our electromagnetic vibration through frequency and all that around. Another thing, going back to Tesla, start to do the research. He was saying that when we look at ancient ruins, they've now found ruins that are something like 12,000 years old. This goes back before the pyramids, you know, and they're finding these things, and they're all similar. They're all circles. They've been built in such a way that they had to have precision tools that they didn't have then. They are all have something to do with sound. They're finding like they're built that when they walk in with their phones or their GPSs don't work. There's something to do with sound going on. Sound shells, things built in like with the Colosseum, that they're built for sound. And we now know that the pyramids not only were built in sound, but they were power plants. They were electrical power plants. That's what they were built for, to make free energy. And so when you go up to what they call the elite, the arseholes of the world, the 1%, they know that. We are just something to make sure that they can play on the planet. You know, they want to have us working. They want to make sure that they've got all the things that they need to play with. And we are basically the sheeple that are out there, you know, kissing their ass, not realizing that. So when you start to detach, in fact, the book, The Streetwise Sheeple, which I finally came with the name of it, and I look at it, you know, if you look at it, you know, here's the sheepdog and here's the sheep all following, and then all of a sudden one sheep says, well, why do I have to follow the sheepdog and go that way? So one sheep just sort of wanders off and heads in another direction, and all the other sheep are still following the sheepdog, and another sheep looks around and says, well, I don't know why I'm following the sheepdog either, so I'm going to go that way. And then another one, and all of a sudden then the sheepdog looks back and there's no sheep. They've all gone into a different direction. That's all it takes. Start to say, what direction am I? Really, first find out that everything you thought isn't what you thought. The history is what we learn. In fact, by teaching this to kids, they'll be going to school going, what the hell am I even going to school for? I'm just learning crap. They don't teach you about the Fibonacci sequence, the flower of life, the numbers, the codes that is in the Bible. The Bible is nothing but codes. Even getting down to the human body, it's saying that build your temple on rock. Build your temple. Your temple is the body. The rock they are talking about is the salts, the cell salts. When we eat, we don't eat food. Our body, our blood doesn't take in food. What happens is through the burning of the food, we take the cell salts, the salts out of it. So when we talk about our salvation is the salts. So the human body is made up the elements of the calcium, potassium, magnesium. That's what the body is made up of. So basically, the structure of the human body needs to have that in the form of salts, not in the form of supplements and that they make. But basically, we are built, our temple is built on the foundation of rock. The foundation is what we are made of. Our bones are like rock. It is like rock. When we die and the life leaves us and the spirit leaves us and we dry, we're like rock. We're petrified, we're like rock when we dry. So, you know, all the way through, these have been misinterpreted. That whoever was channeling through this information at the time was getting it to a certain extent, but didn't know how to articulate it. So the foundation, I mean, make sure that you're, I mean, now with the program that I'm doing, I've guided people through diet all the way through. So living foods, etc. We won't get into that now. But food is secondary. Food is secondary. Vibration is everything. If you're in tune and you've got everything humming, if the electrical system is working in balance and you do eat something wrong, isn't going to make much difference because you're in balance. If you are in balance and you're eating right, oh my God. And I think I went vegan. You know, as I've said, I've lost all my friends. No one ever invites you to a barbecue when you're vegan. They just don't. But, you know, trying all these different ways, and then I realised food was secondary, and what it was getting our frequency right. When you've got that, you start to then, you're tuned in. Your instinct, you're sharp, you know what's right and what's wrong with you. And as has been said by, you know, Hippocrates and that, you know, let thy food be thy medicine, the medicine be thy food. One man's food's another man's poison. Then the right diet for us, but you know, as an individual, comes out. Some people like more warming things. They can't have as much raw as others. I thrive on raw food because I'm such a hot personality. I'm high, so it's cooling to me. In the winter, I'd eat more cooked. But to go all raw, yeah, it will suit some people. To go all cooked, no. I think we need to have raw. It doesn't make sense. But the one key to it, whether you have a combination of a bit more cooked, a bit more raw, a bit more meat, a bit more eggs, whatever, that isn't, that the body will work that out once it's in balance. The one thing is the unprocessed. Anything that is fast food, and we've said earlier on that, you know, don't get these jobs. I would not let my children work at McDonald's. You know, those sort of jobs, you're supporting an industry that is not in our best interest.
What are you drinking at the moment?
You're not going to believe this. It's vinegar and water. So what it is, you know how you can have vinegar to, you can clean your windows with vinegar. It's a cleanser. So what it does is it starts to de-plaque. It cleans out. I'm doing another fast, starting today actually. So
how long does your fast go?
40. I usually do one a year, but this year I'm doing two because I'm just getting my vibration really, really into harmony because I'm writing at the moment. So what that means is I'm high. I'm as high as a kite, just on life, just through the cleansing. When we eat, it takes more energy to digest than what it gives us usually. Especially now as we're coming on to winter here. In the summer when I'm just all raw, not a problem, but now it's colder. So you're wanting, you know, baked potatoes and things like that. And I find that, you know, after a meal, you're a bit tired, you want to go to bed, you know, after you've eaten. This doesn't happen when I fast. What happens is I'm so clear that I'm awake all night and I'm just a channel for information. So my books, I don't write. I can honestly say it's like they write themselves. I never know what I'm going to say until I get there, and then in the same when I speak. When I get up on stage, I remember I had an assistant once and her eyes used to roll back in her head. She'd be saying, like, she knew that it was new information because she's, you never said that before. So when you get into that state and someone asks you a question, it just seems to come through. Like even coming here today, I'm playing Pink Floyd, Stairway to Heaven, and, you know, I've got this whole frequency in that, not in the car, in the headphones in the car, because I'm getting it, this is in this side and this side. And by the time I get here, I'm like, I've just walked in, I'm absolutely high on life. But back to the vinegar. In fact, on the bottle here, it even says, and people sort of miss this, fights arthritis because it gets rid of all inflammation, cleans out, helps digestion, relieves sinus, flu, asthma, sore throat, toxins and crystals, which is like gout and that sort of thing, from joints, tissues and organs. So what I do with the vinegar and water is make sure that, yep, that one's got a little bit of honey in it. You can have it without the honey. Sometimes I put too much in, you take a mouthful and you're like, wah, can't, it's just really sour. So the little bit of honey doesn't hurt. And this is the mother. I've got the mother in it, so it's real. This is the Bragg's one. There's a few different, Melrose, there's a few different ones. But when you put that in water and you're drinking it, it just cleans. It's cleans.
And this is what you'll have on your fast?
Yeah, I'm doing that for 40 days.
Just that?
Yeah, put vinegar and water. Sometimes I do herb teas, like I might put mint or ginger or parsley or coriander, basil, any of the seeds in there, and I'll drink Celtic salt. The Celtic salt, see, when I fast, the Celtic salt has all the right elements that are in the periodical table that are meant. In fact, it's the same consistency as amniotic fluid. Our tears are salty, our sweat is salty, our skin's salty, so we need salt. When they say don't have salt, they're right, because they're talking about table salt, so which is just sodium chloride. Sometimes there's iodine in it, but basically it's sodium. So when we have that mineral, natural salt, it replaces all those elements that I need in the body. And then I do tissue salts. So with the tissue salts, there's 12 tissue salts, there's 12 star signs. There's when I start to get into how it all works. And as I said, the Bible was talking about the salts, the rock, calcium fluoride, the rock built on rock, which is the minerals. And when you, what I do is I dissolve them in water and I bless the water. I put all the vibration of love and frequency, so I've got all the elements that I need. I don't need food. My body is going to recycle old cells and garbage and turn that into fuel initially. So I'm replacing everything. I sit there with the water and I'm like, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. What I did once, I was going through this stage, and this sounds crazy too, but this is distilled water, by the way, so everything's been taken out of it. So putting the salt in actually brings it back to a mineral concoction and energizes it. And I had all this stuff going on in life, that I'd had a partner that was, you know, ill, and, you know, business wasn't doing because of his illness and things like that. And I just had all this emotional baggage that I wanted to deal with. and knowing that I didn't want to put thought to it, to add it worse, I looked at, I need to get rid of this. Now, keep in mind that all this stuff that we could call baggage or shit has a vibration to it. So it's out there. It's out there. How do I stop the vibration? Can I think, all right, I want to stop it, I want to stop it? Well, it's already got momentum too. So, and this just came to me as a thing to do. I took that distilled water. I was quite emotional this day over it. And I cried. And I cried into that water. So what I was doing, and this was just something, as I said, that just occurred to me to do. So what I was consciously doing, subconsciously doing, consciously, was putting the pain of all that I was going through into that water, then to purify it. So to then say, I forgive, there's love, you know, it was a wonderful experience that I've had of that, that is no more. His partner was dying, there was just stuff going on. And I cleansed it, I purified that vibration. Nicole, I drank that water and I had a healing crisis that you wouldn't believe. Within moments, all of a sudden this finger had so much pain in it, I couldn't move it, and I wasn't associating it with that initially. But I just felt pain. I got up to go to the toilet and almost couldn't walk, like my whole body was riddled with arthritis. When I got up from the toilet, I was absolutely normal again. This happened over about 3 days where I was getting this intermittent pain. It would come and go so instantly, it wasn't funny. After that, I felt new. I felt new. I felt there was no, I just didn't give any more thought to it. It wasn't like I even thought that I didn't give any more thought to it. It was like, oh, I haven't even thought about that. And then I went back to remembering what I'd done with the water. And it was like, well, what I look at now, what I'd done was take it and transmute that negative energy, that pain, that vibration of all that. I transmuted it. Bible talks about transmutation, take it up through the heart chakras. What I'd done was transmuted by simply, I forgive all the stuff that has happened, it was an experience, loving the experience of what was happening. And basically putting it through my body, which was at the correct vibration now, because I got rid of all that and now I was starting to dance again and, you know, feel the joy in, and completely work that energy, because energy doesn't disappear. So if it's out and it's negative, it's going to keep bouncing around and, you know, affecting all sort of things. So what I've done is basically take that back in and transmute it and put it back out. Sounds crazy, but it worked. So I've had this, you know, transformation. So I don't know if it'd work for everybody, but certainly to, you know, get rid of that emotion, put it somewhere, put it into a cup.
Makes sense.
Put it into a cup and then change it. As we've talked about with Dr. Emoto, you know, the freezing of water crystals and those that have been blessed, where the crystal is a beautiful flower, and on the other side where it's not, where it's been cursed, it's just got no pattern. It's ugly looking water. It was like the water in my body had become ugly, for want of a better word, or disorganized, because I'm thinking, oh, the business is going to go down the tube, the partners can't do it, his wife's dying, he's got cancer, all these things are going on, oh, you know, I put all this money into it, I'm going to lose it all. And there was all this negativity in my water. And it was like, I guess I can look at it, you know, being a homeopath too, I put it in. And then literally succussed it. I'd taken all the negative out and rewritten that script, put it in and then drake it back through. As that. So it just all of a sudden was like, we've dealt with it. We've dealt with it. And they've shown with polluted waters where people have prayed over it or blessed it, that the water, you know, stops being polluted, becomes clean again. Or you take that disorganized water crystal and you start to give it love and it comes back into harmony again. So basically I was bringing it all back into harmony again. And now when I work with people, like with the program, I really get them to understand them too. There's no point going into, you know, getting the right vibration unless you're working on you too. Who the hell am I? I do this through profiling, through understanding your star signs, through understanding biorhythms, natural cycles that go through the planet. So I get people to really, where they walk in and they go, I know who I am. I know I'm an extrovert. I know I'm an introvert. I know I'm just understand who you are. From there, that's your natural side. Then you start to know when you bring into balance what you're bringing into balance. Mm-hmm. And you know, me being an extreme extrovert, off the Richter scale of extroverts, but then I like my quiet time. I don't go out, you know. People think, oh, you're out there all the time. No, I go out and I speak. I come in, I put my tracksuit on, my moccasins on. I don't leave that house very rarely. I like that side. I like my family is everything. So, you know, the grandchildren and the children, which are grown up adults now, that's my little bit of heaven, you know. That's where I spend my time. So when we say extrovert, people think you're always out there, you're always partying, you know. I just don't do that. But you see that in me and you think that I am. And I realised that, you know, I once thought that I had to be out to be seen. No, no. Go out, do your thing, come back in, recharge. And it's understanding that about ourselves. I mean, look at you. You've been up and down and all around the world sort of thing and still trying to work out who you are. When you get that, you start to go, right, now I can work. Now I've worked on kind of the physical, the mind side of me. Like, you get your diet right, you disconnect from the matrix that is keeping us diseased, and you start to go, right, now I'm going to nurture my soul. Now I'm going to get into that side of it. That's what they call good food, soul food, I guess. But, yeah, another time I'll talk about, you know, biblical texts or ancient texts where they were talking about, you know, the human body and the river, you know, the Tigris, the Euphrates, all this. They're talking about the river, you know, the blood system and the lymphatic system. I remember when I was studying, I was in a class on pharmacology where we understand drug interactions and, you know, how they affect us. And, of course, I don't believe we should be taking any drugs, really. But there was a teacher who was a very very religious woman, actually, but she'd brought the book of Job. And something just rang true with it, even though I'm not a religious person, something rang true. And then I started to, so therefore when I'm reading things, I'm reading to say, what if all this is about the human body? What if it's about the human body? And that the, you know, your house was this, and that the light was within, and that you were everything. And then you start to look at where they've said, as is above is below. Above is outside of us, below is inside of us. And they've now shown that when you go in the human body into small enough, you know, in the microscope, you go down, there's as much space in here as there is out there. So really that's a mirror. This is where the astrologers of ancient times, they were the purest of all people, more than the monks. The astrologers, they didn't drink, they didn't smoke, they didn't party, they didn't do anything. They just sat and gazed at stars. And they were the purest and purest of people. And they kept their body that way so they could get the information that was coming through. And basically what is in the stars, or the 12 star signs, is mirrored within the human body. There are 12 systems within the body, 12 star signs, 12 tissue salts. And I teach this on the program, and all of a sudden you go, wow, I'm reading these, what we would call religious texts or spiritual texts, through different eyes now. It's all a map to us. It's not a map to the universe, it's a map, the universe is a map to us. It's a map, you know, to how you get this temple of right, you know, the temple of God. Let the light in. The light is from the inside. It's the inside that's shining out. You start to get it. So I had this fascinating, this thing with the human body, and I started to look at reading books on how we die, what happens in this out-of-body experiences, and as you know, filming on it, and all of a sudden I just went, oh my God, it's all about, every book was telling us, it's all about here. And we give our power out. All you've got to do is get in tune. Everything comes to you. You realise how your systems work. You have a different respect. You would, there'd be no way you'd put a Twinkie bar in there. You just wouldn't, give me an apple. Put some peanut butter on it if you want to, you know, pimp it up a little bit, but you wouldn't do it. You wouldn't do it.
I'm a little bit stumped. There's so much information.
How much do you get out in this time? Yeah, well, that's why the program. I'd like to run people. I've consumed myself. It's now the fifth month, and for 5 months in the year, I have daily consumed myself with meditation, with dance, with 528 frequency, with all different frequencies. I've had Bach on there. They were playing, someone was playing Bach at one of the cathedrals in Los Angeles, and they said that people were sitting in certain places where the sound was coming through, were having out-of-body experiences. When it finished, they didn't get up and clap. They were all just shell-shocked. They were like, something happened to me just now because of that vibration. They know that. That's why they've played. That's why the Illuminati are having, you know, artists out there that are negative in our frequency, where they're keeping us down, because they realize there's more of us than them. And if we change our frequency, then all of a sudden we have the power out of them. They can only get in through mind control. If we don't allow our mind to be controlled, we can't be mind controlled. Same when you look at the alien agenda, they're a different frequency. They want us down. When we rise above, no fear. Say, hey, do what you like. I just love you guys anyway. They're like, oh, shit, we can't do anything with her because she realizes the power of her mind, the power of my mind. My mind is alive. My thoughts are alive. They're just as alive as me. They're just as alive as me, Nicole. So when I put that out, that has a limit. That goes into, it's like a, if you want, this is something David Icke says, if you want to affect the fish in the ocean, you affect the ocean. You affect the ocean, you affect the fish. We are fish in this ocean. So they know that through electromagnetic poisoning, vaccination, drugs, electromagnetic poisoning, mind control, don't worry about what's happening over here, just focus, learn your ABCs, learn this. When you try to step out of it, the teacher's like, no, come back and focus that. They don't want us to look at something else. So you say, well, what if I do look at something else? So all of a sudden you're like, I'm going to just dabble a little bit here. And the more you look, and then you go, none of that is even real. And yet you're caught up with, you know, you've got children that are still going through that system. It's painful to watch. You go, how do I live in both? The only thing you can do is study this and play the game as if you're that. Most people, I mean, the way that we get caught up in keeping up with the Joneses, so to speak, most people have one good, you know, not most people, there are people there that have one or two cars that could buy 15 reasonable cars that would still do the job, mm-hmm. You know. Don't put your money into things like that. Don't get bigger screen TVs. Get no TV. Get rid of as much as you can. I did an experiment once.
Microwaves.
Oh, I don't have one. Don't want one. No, I don't. If I go into a restaurant, I say, if you microwave my food, if I hear a microwave going in the back, I won't eat that food. Oh, well, ma'am, we actually can't give you that because that's how we heat it up. All right, well, that's fine. I won't have that, you know. Trans fats, you know, all those sort of unnatural things. I pick and choose where I go. I want raw, I want this, I want that, I don't want that, that and that. And if I'm too hard, well, you know, sorry, but I just want what's the best for me. Doesn't mean I won't have a bit of sticky date cake, a little poison. I pick my poisons. But I'm very careful about, I think more than the food, you can be careful about the food, you can cleanse your body. The more than anything is your thinking. Your thinking and your vibration. Well, it's the thinking about not thinking, it's the tuning out, so to speak. And now I was walking through New York Airport once and I had a download. I'm on a high. This is a change of subject, but I'm very heavily into the research and have a business involvement in stem cells. And looking at stem cell research and basically, you know, the fountain of youth type thing, and was just on a high after this meeting with this person in New York. All of a sudden, boom, download. I now feel it. I felt it, and I have said this when I was on an underground in LA. I feel like a warmth without a light. It's like there's a light there, as in I can feel the heat from it, but it's not a light that you can see. And I feel it coming in. And when it comes in, sometimes like you heat up, you know, you call it menopause, it's almost like my inner child playing with matches or something, you know. But you get this and something is coming. I now know that it's something coming in, different to a hot flash from a menopause thing, different. There's no sweating with this one. But you get these things happen. Now I bring it on through getting myself into an altered state of being, and you can bring it on. But sometimes it doesn't happen. I think what it is, it's like they, God, folks, whatever it is, seems to give us the information when we're ready to deal with it. So you get to a level of understanding, and another bit comes. And, you know, there's no point downloading someone who wasn't ready. Well, maybe they have. They're the ones in the mental asylums. You know, it's like, oh God, I've got all this, and now I'm talking to something, and I, you know,
are they really that mental though?
You're insane. Well, that's it. Well, what gets me is you can get someone that can get out there and say, there's underground alien bases, and, you know, history of man, we've been colonized by much more advanced beings than us, and you know, the planet has gone through cycles and it's cleansed itself, and you have come up, and you can talk about all this, and they will lock you up if you talk out too loud, and especially when you get into the politics of why $15 trillion has gone missing in gold and things like that. They'll want to assassinate you. So why do they want to do that? If you're actually mad, they just say, oh, you're mad. But they don't say they're mad. They want to assassinate them. They want to get rid of them. Because they say, if enough people listen, they think, hang on, they're not mad. They're actually telling the truth about what's happening. The amount of people. It's like the assassination, you know. To me, you can't be assassinated unless you let that vibration in. It's like, I've got this white light around. You can't touch me because I'm telling the truth, and that's all there is to it. You just tell the truth and you stand, you hold your ground. Enough people pick up on that.
It really comes from fear, then, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, if you fear, you allow that in, and that fear will kill you. That fear will leave with you.
But that's basically what...
You don't let them into the field, you know. They can only get to you by you allowing them in on a mental level. Don't allow them in. It's like, I'm going to give no thought to that. If I can't think, if I can't stop thinking about that, if I've got shit in my life that I can't stop thinking about, what I'll do is I'll distract myself by listening to 528 hertz or vibration or frequency, and I'll get into that to distract myself from that until I can start to. And then all of a sudden you feel it. You know, I'll sit in my car and I'm going, I love my kids, I love my life, oh, I love the trees, oh, look at those beautiful trees, oh, look at that. And all of a sudden I'm just stop. I don't have the radio on in the car anymore. I will have the headset on because I like to have the, you know, the coming in, but, you know, the sound, and it's tuning left and right. And even with forms of hypnosis, they do, you know, you might be following the candle, or you're going backwards and forwards, or you're following a sound, dun, 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 because you've got left and right hemisphere. So what it's doing is getting them to align. And we're not taught how to use the right side. We are as babies. We're already there. I mean, my little grandkids, they'll be sitting there looking at things, and I say, oh, what are you looking at, all the little angels and little fairies up there? And daughter would say, stop saying that, Mum. You're freaking me out. And it's like, it's true. It's true.
Well, they can see the things that...
We had, one of my daughters, when she was about two, three, she could talk very, very well, sitting in the lounge room, and all of a sudden she jumped onto her father's knee and said, man, 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 across the other side of the room, and like there was no one there. But she was, because she was playing, and all of a sudden she looked up and jumped. So she saw it. It wasn't a funny, you know, fuzzy type image. She obviously saw something solid. And she was quite frightened, so it had to calm her down. And later we found that that house, a man had died in that room. He'd been kicked by a horse in the chest, went in that night, was sitting in the chair and died of bleeding internally. So there was a man. And she said, man, man, man. He was there. Well, of course, the older kids were like, oh, we're not going to sleep in here again. I said, he's not here to harm us. It's just that's where he's sort of been hanging around. He was a loner. He lived on his own. He didn't have anyone. So he's hanging around with us. But Rhiannon saw him very clearly, very clearly. But we say, you know, we say, oh, don't be silly. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. So we make the kids think that that is their imagination instead of its
reality.
I've seen stuff with a girlfriend, went to her place, and I'm outside and looking in as if you're looking into the kitchen here. And I said, there's someone in your kitchen. There's someone standing there. I can sort of see the energy of them. She said, you see it too? And I said, yeah, they're right there. And she said, how do you see it? And I said, it's like as if someone had a toaster on the floor and you would see the heat rising. You would see the energy of it. That's what I can see. I can see a heat, like a vibration of energy, a denseness of energy. Couldn't see the person, but I could pick that there was energy there, and I can always pick if they're male or female. The female energy, it's just, you just know, it's just a softer energy than a male energy. So I look at that now and are very much aware of it. You know, just stop seeing what you're seeing, adjust your eyes a little bit, and you kind of can pick up. Now, I don't see anything in here, but in Haley's house, I've seen it quite a few times now. So there's someone that lives in her house. We had an episode when I was living in Melbourne many years ago where there was this thing that lived there, and she liked to move stuff. She'd steal Tupperware, and I mean, she'd steal it for a whole year, then all of a sudden it'd turn up. A cupboard above the stove where you had to actually lift it upwards. So you had to, being short, you had to hop on a stool and get up and push it upwards. So you couldn't lift it up without being on the stool. You could open it, but it would close again. So here it was, and every morning just about that would be over. Oh, there's a little poltergeist has been at this thing again. Moved things around the house, moved some clothing of hers. Stuff would disappear. We moved house once. So you move, you pack everything, not there. When we unpacked, there it was. Within a box of clothes, there was some Tupperware. So it was like clothes, Tupperware, clothes. We didn't pack it that way. The Tupperware was in the Tupperware cupboard, or the, you know, and the clothes were there, and it was like being put back in. And we go, how do these things go missing? You know, they were there, they're not there, not taken out of the house. So, you know, you get ones that are a bit mischievous and like to sort of move things around. So, when you know, you put it all together, we talked about the 12 apostles. That information I channeled through. I did this, I was part of a documentary for someone else, and they were looking at the 10 areas of life. And I walked away and I went, no, there's 12. And yet I couldn't tell you what the others were, but then all of a sudden I just started writing and I realised, oh my God, there's 12. So hence the 12 apostles, the 12 star signs, the 12 systems of the body, the 12 tissues, souls, the 12 months in the year. And all of a sudden I went, of course, there's got to be 12. When you look at numbers, like earlier on we were talking about, you know, the human body. And the body, you know, your temple is built on a rock, and the, and these 12 tissue salts, all looking at numbers, the body is mostly carbon 12. Carbon 7 is the white, or the grey matter in the brain. So when you look at, you know, what the body is made up of, carbon mostly, and the whole, you know, you look at, all of a sudden you start to look at the body different. You don't look at the mouth and what I'm going to eat. You look at what this is and what sort of fuel it needs. Like I've often said to people, you wouldn't put, you know, no name, well, I suppose people do these days, but put no name fuel in your car because you don't know what it is and what damage it's going to do. And yet we'll open our mouth like a mini skip and throw anything in and not realize what it'll do. We'll have electromagnetic poisons, as in, you know, a microwave going and electromagnetic fields around, not realizing what they're doing to the body. They're silent killers. So when you get a better understanding of, you know, like we've talked about today, we've talked about vibration, we've talked about my downloads, and I don't want people to think it's about my downloads. A lot of us are having these near-death experiences while still alive. In other words, something is changing in the planet. And something out there is on our side and saying, right, you wake up, you wake up, you wake up, you wake up, you're ready. Let's start to get some stuff happening. So then you feel alone in that because you go, well, you know, who do I talk about? You talk about to a few people, once you do get the courage to talk about it, and they don't know what you're talking about, so now you're back on your own again. So it's finding those like-minded. I found this is where I've written this program, is to say, well, firstly, let's get your body right. Let's get the physical side. Let's get the emotional, the mental. Let's tune you in. Let's get the GPS working. Let's find that. And then you start to find like-minded people during that process. When you do...
Isn't that another vibration?
What?
As well, you find like-minded people because you're...
Well, yeah, that's it. You start to attract that frequency to you. And it's uniting those of us together. And that's what the project does, to sort of pull it together, and we say, right, now we're becoming quite a powerful force, you know, force, which is a guiding force that says, okay, now we know this is the dark side. I don't want to spend any more time, I mean, other than research. I research, but I don't get involved in it as in changing my vibration. I can sit there and go, oh my God, doom and gloom. You know, they're poisoning us, they're vaccinating us, they want to get rid of the elderly, they want to dampen the child's immune system for life. So as by 65, we don't need them anymore. They can, you know, we can, you know, feed them to the dinosaurs. You know, no need for humans unless they're of a certain, you know, they're either childbearing or, you know, this and this. So what happens is you start to get them and then you start to unite. When we do, I believe that we all have certain gifts, like some people can sing, some people can't, some people are good with computers, some people are good, you know, that when you start to get that like-minded groups together, and especially when we look at the profiles, the eight profiles, in fact, it makes me wonder now if there's really 12. When you start to look at the flower of life or the Fibonacci sequence, you start to go, the numbers are all over the body and the distance between our arms and the shape of their face and all that sort of thing, and you go, well, it makes sense that inside we're numbers as well. In other words, it's a code. We're like a biological computer, a living computer. It's all done in code. And when you understand it, you understand what you need to change code, what you need to get rid of bugs and viruses in the code, and not add to the I don't know how to explain it, because there's not really words, but you know, if your computer's not running properly,
it's a disease,
you've just got to clean it all out. So when you look at the bigger picture, like you're saying, it goes into, we get back into numbers, basically. I forgot where I was going with all of that, but we go back into the numbers. So when you look at the big, in fact, I'm going to look, I'm pretty sure we'll come up with 12, because we've got 12 star signs as 12 profiles, and I'm guaranteed they're in there. Because that's what Genghis Khan, I Ching, came up with the eight. So there's no doubt a couple of hidden ones. I think we've left out the lizard people and the aliens and a few others in there. So when you start to look at all of that and you get people together, we have, that's where I was going, with different skills. I'm not great with the whole computer mechanism and programs, but I can, you know, get through information and get someone else to build it for me. And I think, you know, once you start to unite with like-minded, all of a sudden we're now thinking the same way, or we're not really thinking in the way we're open to channeling of the information. I mean, anyone, and I keep mentioning Nikola Tesla, because he's just a hero to me, you know. And people like that were getting through information, and it was coming from a greater a knowing. And so when we get together, the vibration of those people together, the harmony that we have together, we start to make decisions and make changes. And
that vibration would then get bigger and more stronger.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's why prayer in groups and things like that, you know, it's all worked. And if you look at it, that there's math behind it. It's like living math. Everything is math. Then you start to understand that when you're thinking and you're putting your thought out there, if there's a different structure to it, if it's more structured, you start to understand how it can come together. It's like when I think now of something I want, I think of a box that I'm building. So I go, well, here's the structure of it, here's the walls of it, this is what it's going to look like. And I don't really fill in the blanks. I allow the universe to do that. I go, this is just the structure of what I want. Because if I start to think, and then I'm going to do this, and I'm going to fill it with that, and fill it with that, and fill it with that, then I'm not allowing my thinking's getting in of what I want as a personal choice, as opposed to what the universe is actually sending me as the right choice for me. So I lose detachment to it. And we get very caught in, but this is the way it has to be, and we become very rigid. And I think with this process, like you were saying earlier on, you know, what do we believe? Do we believe this or we believe that? The thing is to have no belief. Just be open to information. And that's when people are researching this for themselves. They start to find, let me not take it personally. Let me just research that and not give it any thought. Then research that and research that. And you start to see the similarity. You start to see the bullshit very, very clearly. And you start to see those that it's coming from the truth. And the ones that are coming the truth is almost so far-fetched that the bullshit's easier to believe. It's easier to believe. So when you get out of that and you start to sort of come in and just go, look, I'm just going to take that information in and not going to judge it, not going to judge it, because it's too much for us to look at anyway. You know, if we're only just working out the technology behind the pyramids and things that are in the last 4,000 or 5,000 years. What about pre that? What about stuff we're finding that goes back, you know, 12, 15, 20, 30,000? They've found skeletons, as I've said, of people in coal that's 30 million years old. This planet has been colonized and destroyed and colonized and destroyed and colonized and destroyed over and over and over. Now, so that says that, you know, is our destruction imminent? You know, can't give a date. People sort of put times, like the Mayan calendar, they were talking about the end of the world. They weren't talking about the end of the world. They were talking about the end as we know. We were going to another plane. Well, it had happened. In fact, 2011, things started to change with people, not on a physical level, on an emotional, on a mental level, and people are starting to awaken. So we're going into that new dawn, that new age, and it's a new way of thinking. In other words, we didn't We didn't see the bullshit 100 years ago. We didn't have the capacity to even think that that was possible. Now, with technology where it is, if anything, the elite families will probably grow to regret that, because now we can find out the information. We're finding out the information to the Nazis and the Rockefeller and the Rothschilds and the old. They're all connected. The world is run by just a few. You know, we say, oh, we've got this government here and that government there. They're all the same. They're just different experiments. We'll try how this works in America, and we'll see how this works in China, and we'll see how this works in England, and we'll see how this works in America. It's all basically the same system. They're just trying different ways. And that gives us the illusion of, like, well, this is how we are, and that's how they are, and that's how we're different to them. We're all just one. We're all one. We're all just part of an experiment where we're living. Well, when you detach from it and you sit back and you think, I'm not going to play that game. I'm going to disconnect myself. I'm going to have my home, my family, and I'll go shopping. I'll do all those things. Look like I'm playing the game, but I'm certainly not buying anything that's GMO, and I'm certainly not going to buy any processed food, and I'm certainly going to try and buy, you know, organic and farmers markets, and let me see if I can grow some tomatoes and cucumbers and, you know, something up along the fence, and, you know, grow some of my own, and make sure that I don't have water out of the tap if it's fluoride. I don't want to calcify my pineal gland, which is my opening. Then, you know, the light of the body is the eye. If the eye be singular, the light be very bright. I mean, this is stuff out of the Bible. They're saying the light be singular. It's the third eye. The light is within.
That's just so interesting.
So I'm looking forward to this program getting out, and, you know, having people say, finally, this is the one workshop I only ever have to do. The wealth, instead of how to make money and how to find the right relationship, this is how you work. Physically, emotionally, everything about the human body, how you work as a fine piece of equipment. When you get that and you understand you, then the rest just comes as it's supposed to be, and you find you're not so interested in the money. Doesn't mean we don't want a little bit of money. You're not so interested in the money. You're interested in peace. You're interested in harmony. You're interested in helping stop the wars by not fighting, not causing a revolution, but to go peaceful and say, yeah, look, you can have your war, but none of my boys are going to enlist. Well, none of us are going to enlist. None of us are going to pick up a gun. All of a sudden, these guys at the top that don't have balls, you know, don't. Who's going to be fighting? Who's going to be fighting? You know, I think that as the next 20 years evolves, people will start to change. You know, you say, no, you're not going to have this sort of job or that sort of job. Let's keep out of that. And, of course, there's people now at the top that are coming out and actually really coming out with the truth of what's going on. There's an organisation, the White Hats. Start to research. Once you get to one, you start to get... And there is a lot of crap out there. There's a lot of crap out there. So you start to sort of look through it and you go, bullshit. Hang on, I'll put that aside and that aside. And then you start to see the similarities in things. Nicole, it's been a pleasure, actually. I'm glad that we've had this sit down to talk about all these sort of things in life. And I'm looking forward to working with you on the program and getting this information out there. And
I'm looking forward to being your student.
Well, it's already worked. You're on the vinegar and water. I'm just going to get you on the cell salts. And human body is very important. It's very important to get that into balance. And you talked about fasting. You know, people think, oh, you're going to die. I mean, you know, many, many ancient scrolls have talked about 40-day fasting. And it basically, the body will not eat itself. It will go through cleansing. It'll eat dead, decaying old matter, your old cells, anything that's mutated, so anything that's starting to be cancerous, or anything that started to go wrong, it'll start to eat it. After the 40 days, you do get that, now I'm actually hungry. You're not hungry except for the first 3 days. And the first 3 days, you go, oh, I'm just going to get through day one. Okay, got through day one. Now day two. Day three, day four, you're fine. And I can be cooking a meal for the family and not even miss the fact that I'm not even eating. It just doesn't occur to you. You just don't feel hungry. And you lose weight, and then you have a lot of fun putting it back on again later, you know, getting into nuts and all those sort of things. But I don't do it to lose weight. I'm not a big person, so I don't have weight to lose as such.
You are very bright, though.
Yeah, well, this is the vinegar and all the cleaning, you know, but plus keep in mind, you know, even on the way here, I've got in the right frequency. So I've come here vibrating at that. And I find with the not eating, it's so easy to do, because you're not laying down overnight trying to meditate and having this digest, you know, it's not going on, it's not there, so all you're lighter. And you wake up, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning, you're wide awake and you want to get up and do something, so, which is great. I find that when I do, like if I eat out, and often they do add stuff to the food that they don't tell you they've added, you know, just not spices and herbs, but stock cubes and things like that that aren't particularly great, when you can just add your Celtic salt, of course. But I have a hangover from the food. I'm not drinking, I have a hangover from the food. I'm sluggish the next morning, so be careful of eating out. Salt's all we need, the Celtic salt, of course. But I really, in the program, one of the things that I go into, firstly, is to find out who you are. We do the whole personality profile. And then secondly, we get into the diet. And then we get into the other side once you've got yourself cleaned out. But that side, and it's always fascinating for people when, you know, I'm going through different things that were said in the Bible. As again, I said, I'm not religious, I'm not going that way at all, but just, you know, especially when you consider that 70,000 texts were covered up by the Vatican on vibration, on frequency, on sound, on how it moves us, and but just the body being the, you know, what is needed for the human body to actually thrive. And it's not as we think. It's been said all the way through.
Well, it sounds...
People think you eat the food. You don't eat the food. It's the energy. It's the vibration that gets out. It's the energy that's there, and it's the energy of the structure, which is the salts.
Yeah, well, it seems very comprehensive course. I love the way it's about mind, body, and soul.
Dumbing it down. Yeah,
as opposed to just diet or just counselling or...
You have to put the lot in there. It's
about loving yourself at the end of the day, isn't it? That's the vibration.
Yeah. At the end of the day, I know that I can get people to where I have come, as in with vibration and that. I know that is very, very possible. There's nobody you can't get to. In the end, I've had years as a counsellor too, so I've heard all the problems, and then I go, all right, we've heard that, but let's work on this. And I have people, you know, often, oh yeah, but I want to talk about my problem. I say, I already know your problem, it's a vibration, I know that, let's go to that. And I've had people sitting there crying because they want to tell you how bad their day is, or how bad their week is, or how bad their relationship is. I say, I'm here to change your frequency. Well, let's move you up. But they don't even hear until you change their frequency, because they're blocked out. It's like if you're in this box, you can't let the truth in, because you will filter it through your belief system. So if you say, I am a Catholic, or I am a Muslim, or I am a Jew, you have a set of guidelines. That's your box. So anything that comes in, your mind is already filtering it and puts it out. In other words, you're not even hearing what I say. If I say to you, repeat everything I said, you'd only get the bits that agree with your system. You just literally didn't hear it. And you would say, and if I said, look, if we played that back and I said, this is what I say, they'd go, I didn't even hear you say that. And yet, we've got it on camera. I see that all the time. They do not listen because it's already boom, boom, boom. It's like they've bounced it off themselves, because it doesn't go in with their belief. And their belief that they're holding on to makes them, as they see it. So if it doesn't get into my belief, that means it challenges my belief. And if it challenges my belief, oh, can't have that, because that's my belief.
Oh, well, so then it makes the person feel uneasy within themselves, probably nervous, and brings about fear, which is what you...
So you take all that out. But that's why if you get the body right, if you get them feeling right, then all of a sudden they're open to it too. But I find with counselling, some first and second sessions, I can't even get into making any change, because they won't let me in.
That reminds me of the 5 o'clock.
They want help, but they won't let me in.
5 o'clock news. The amount of people, including my father, that are addicted to the 5 o'clock news, because they're used to the doom and gloom and the worrying, and it would be. Did you hear that story?
I don't have. I've never listened to the news. I'm not ever. I won't even put a radio on.
I wonder what's actually real anyway.
I don't want, you know, with this flight that's gone missing, and I go, that's all bullshit anyway. I don't want to hear. I don't want to put that in there, because I don't want to think for 60 seconds afterwards on that subject, which is a lie. It's all controlled. All the media's in control. They're finding cure for cancers. They're doing this and that. That's the information I want to know. I'm going to Google that. I'm more likely to find it behind the news, the real stories, there than what I am in the news. Switch it off. You don't miss a damn thing.
Yeah, what's real, what's not real.
People say, do you read the newspaper? What? I don't have a newspaper. But I'm not, you know, I'm not ignorant to what's going on. I'm more in tune to what's really going on than the average person.
Yes.
What I talk about is what's really going on. What this person talks about is what's in the news, or what happened to that flight, or what happened to that, or did you hear about that death, or did you hear about that? Not interested in that. Not interested in that at all.
Decluttering your mind of that,
yeah,
too.
Yeah. Let's organise those that are ready to stand up. Let's organise them.